Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Order, please. This is the June 17th, 2019, 7 p.m. meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, and all five commissioners are present. So, Commissioner Carter, if you would please lead us in the invocation and the Pledge of Allegiance.
Join me in prayer, please. Father God, as we join to hear tonight, dear Lord, we join together about the business of Alamance County. We ask, Father God, for you to guide us, that our thoughts, our actions will be acceptable in your sight, that the direction we seek to take is the right direction for the citizens of Alamance County, dear Lord, that we will be preparing Alamance County for its future. We know we have a bright future if we're led by you, Father God. We ask, Father, to be with us as we meditate and deal with the business of the county. Be with us as we leave here tonight and take us home safely, all of us, dear Lord. We ask these things in the powerful and holy name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, the first item on our order of business tonight is to recognize the people who have completed the 2019 Spring County Government Academy, which we call County Government 101. So this is a group of people from Alamance County who have come to take a course organized through the Manager's Department and by Tori Frank. She works very hard on this program. And so each week they learn about a different aspect or different facet of county government. So one week they go to the landfill, one week they spend some time with the sheriff and learn about him and his the mission of his department, and many other DSS, many other agencies. And so they've graduated, and tonight they get their certificates. So I'm going to come around, and I'll call your name. We had 13 people, I believe, to participate this time, and we don't have everybody here tonight to get their certificates, but we have plenty. We're so excited and grateful for you all for sacrificing your time to come and learn more about Alamance County and county government, and I hope you found it to be rewarding and enjoyable experience. So I'll call your name and come on up, Sarah Elizabeth Carroll. If you want to stay here, and then after everybody comes up, then we'll take a picture as a group. Okay, Scott Case. And Brian Conlon. And Dylan Galloway. Yeah, it's kind of tight up here. And Sigalema Lynch. Tamara Patterson. Patricia Pell. Thank you.
Tommy Purcell.
Got his own chair and squat.
And last but not least, it must be Craig Thompson. All right, so if y'all would come on over here and we will get a group picture. Short people in the front.
Short.
Tall in spirit.
Come on in.
Switch lenses, I'm sorry.
Can
you guys just hold that pose?
What do you do, run out of battery?
Wrong lens.
Everybody? Sir, you and glasses, can you scoot over a little bit more? I'm not sure where. That's good.
Okay, that's okay.
That's enough.
And Tori, when will the next class start?
In the fall.
Okay, so the next class will start around about September, and it's been fun to see how this, you know, nice group has come together, and it seems like they got along and they're friends. So that's awesome. Okay, so next item on the agenda tonight is our public speakers on topics that are related to the agenda, which looks like it's all the speakers that we have. We have six people signed up to speak, and we have a really long agenda, folks. So I'm going to hold people to pretty firmly. You have a 3-minute time limit for public comments, and I'm going to hold folks to that pretty firmly, because we have a lot of things to get accomplished tonight. So we do have a public comment policy that's available for review on our website. I would encourage everybody to look at that if you're thinking about making a public comment. It's kind of common sense that, you know, don't be ugly and say rude things about other people, and, you know, stick to the topic, and that you get 3 minutes, and that there is a total time limit of 30 minutes. So. With that being said, the first speaker tonight is Frank Bell.
Frank Bell, 1411 Boone Road. Last meeting, we requested for farmland preservation $100,000 more for our preservation, which was $250,000 budget. Commissioner Lasser recommended that he increased that $100,000 and charged Mr. Haygood to find $100,000. He went to the and looked and come out with two proposals. One proposal was that we fund it $100,000 and not hire an assistant planner. Option two was, I believe I got the options right, is $50,000. And hire a planning or assistant planning director. I talked to Mr. Moore, Mr. Vaughn Willoughby, and we agreed to take the option of $50,000. Taking under consideration going forward that our needs for planning of land use is very important. It's a major problem in this county. Farmland preservation is very important as well, but we will accept the $50,000. Going forward, I would challenge you in your thinking for budget 2019 or 2021 to do some forward thinking and not some after thinking. that this, we have got $1 million in reoccurring funds every year, and you're aware of that, that we need to use that to budget. That's coming from agricultural community. We need those funds to budget for farmland preservation and any needs that we do in land planning going forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Vaughn.
Thank you, Mr. Bell. Okay, next is Gary Lickney.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I guess you're not wondering why I'm here. Good evening. My name is Gary Lickney, and I reside in Snow Camp, North Carolina. I'm here to speak to the commissioner's resolution to request that the state deny the mining application of Alamance Aggregates. Because I was traveling abroad, I was unable to attend the last commissioner's meeting. However, I was able to watch the video. Can you believe that? I was in Sweden watching the commissioner's meeting. I'm either desperate or not the brightest bulb in the world. As I sat in my hotel room listening to the discussion and proposed resolution, I became very excited. For the first time, I saw the same anger and frustration from the commissioners that we snow camp residents have been experiencing during this entire process. And I want you to know we really appreciate that. More importantly, I heard the commissioners emphatically say we need to do something, which turned out to be instructions to the county attorney to draft a resolution from the commissioners asking the state to deny Alamance Aggregates mining permit. When asked by the commissioners if you could do this, the county attorney's response was, you can do anything you want. Unfortunately, my excitement didn't last long as I read the county attorney's version of the resolution in the agenda, which did not include a request for denial and certainly did not capture the commissioner's concerns and frustrations. Apparently, the county attorney advised the commissioners because the county planning department had already approved the permit, it might open itself up to litigation by requesting denial by the state. The intent of the resolution was also to present the reasons for denial, and concerned citizens have presented a draft resolution that addresses those, the reasons for denial, such as no evaluation of effects on water quality, a woefully inadequate hydrogeological study, and a blasting study that's not site-specific and does not specifically address the concerns raised by Colonial Pipeline and Duke Energy. In the county attorney's version, he also refers to certain citizens and public comments made by some nearby property owners. I want to remind the commissioners and the county attorney that over 400 people turned out for the public hearing at Sylvan Elementary, and not one comment was made supporting the mine. There are over 350 citizens who signed petitions opposing the mine. And if you take a drive through Snow Camp now, you'll see a No Snow Camp Mine sign in nearly every other drive throughout Snow Camp, not just near the mine. This is not just a few disgruntled residents. This is a community trying to protect their agriculture and rural culture, and more important, their quality of life. Even if you cannot ask for a denial, I urge you today to please do something. Your resolution could certainly ask that the application of Alamance Aggregates is complete and meets all requirements to protect the effective citizens and their rights. I want to point out that everything that we're asking them, it had nothing to do with a county permit. These are all new issues that are at the state level, environmental issues. Follow your own mind and send a strong message to the state that we're all concerned, citizens and commissioners, that this mine could have devastating effects on our community and the county. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Lickney. Donna Poe.
Good evening again.
Good evening.
I am Donna Poe from Snow Camp, as you know, and again I want to express my gratitude to each of you for hearing our heartfelt concerns at just about every county commissioner's meeting about the potential threat by the proposed Snow Camp mine to our water, our safety, and the very lives we have built here in Alamance County. Just to look around at the historic, peaceful, quiet Quaker community that is Snow Camp, one would believe it unthinkable that due to a butchered process, a blast stone quarry is lurking in our midst. Yet it happened. At the last meeting, we were so heartened by your request to the county attorney to prepare a resolution for you to send to the state expressing your concerns about the proposed mine. Hardly believing it to be true, the county attorney affirmed that you could send any resolution that you wanted. In thankfulness, we shared the resolution mention and moratorium extension, thank you also for that, to our listserv and Facebook page, in which many praised to include other counties fighting similar battles, your unbelievable care and support. The purpose of our own drafted three-page resolution emailed to you last week was to tie the points listed to specific reasons the state considers for a permit denial as listed in the 1971 Mining Act Article 7, which we've all become very familiar with. That finished resolution might have had some teeth with fact, or would have some teeth with fact-based accounts for the state to seriously consider in its review process. Again, our concerns, as were yours, are our access to well water, which we have no other options, the threat of stormwater contamination of our wells and surface water, including streams and wetlands, and the threat to our lives from blasting adjacent to the Colonial Hazardous Liquid Pipeline. If you have a chance to review the recent submission from the mining company to the state, and the clock is ticking on that, you will see that the so-called studies are once again deficient, with only references to other areas unrelated to this specific site. However, if the county attorney insists that you rather send a resolution to the state merely expressing the concerns of the citizens versus your own, which was drafted, then we request that he at the very least frame those concerns accurately. For example, the state has no jurisdiction over home values or residential development. That should have been a HIDO issue, but since it was not, we don't bring that up except as necessary for the new HIDO. We have made edits to the county attorney's draft, I have a copy for each of you, that corrects some of his miscommunication and also added a clause to state that neither the commissioners nor the citizens were notified or had the opportunity to review the county HIDO application until after it was issued. That can at least give the state an idea of why you were sending the resolution. In addition, I see no reason to state something that you were not saying. For example, that you were not advocating that any permit be denied. This statement is in direct conflict with your public statements from our last meeting and creates confusion in our community. We request that that statement be stricken. Thank you once again for your time and leadership representing the concerned citizens of Alamance County.
Okay, Laura Johnson.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Laura Johnson. I'm from resident of Snow Camp. I'm speaking tonight on the commissioner's resolution. When I originally heard about the proposed resolution, which included the voices and the support of the commissioners, I felt like a step was being taken forward in the right direction and that we were actually seeing something done to help right this wrong in our community. I'm here tonight to ask you to remember that resolve and remember the emotions behind why you all put support behind that. And like Donna said, to also send forth a resolution that has facts and some teeth to it. We've heard mentioned in this very room that our county needs this project and that we need this stone for our growth, but a member of our group spoke with Martin Marietta just last week, and they confirmed that their Alamance quarry right now is running at 50% capacity, and they're sharing a crew between two of the quarry locations. So in fact, you know, there is not this undying need for this to be in our community right now, despite the growth that we have going on. On the flip side, we're talking about an awful lot of risk for Snow Camp that would be associated with this. And so, you know, looking further and looking at the opposite side of the equation, I'm going to quote a section of the county's own land use plan, which says, quote, most of Alamance County's growth has occurred in the southern and eastern portions of the county along its border with Chatham and Orange County, basically in Snow Camp. The key factors fueling that growth are residential, quality of life, and amenities related to that. The current and future residents of Snow Camp are going to need access to, among other things, clean water, clean air, safe roads, and that quality of life that brought them there in the first place. Same as an earlier speaker also mentioned, you know, farmland preservation is a big deal, and it should be something that our county is looking at. Historic area preservation should be something that we're looking at. To keep all of these amenities, I think we need to think long and hard about what's essential and what's not. Clearly, if we have quarries running at 50% capacity, this is not an essential project right now for our county. What is fixable and what can be irreparably lost is also something that we need to seriously think about. And I think we need to take any opportunities to fix this situation right now in Snow Camp that we have. As you've heard from the other speakers tonight, this isn't just an issue in Snow Camp, it's the issue. I spend just about every Saturday standing down at the Snow Camp store, selling our signs, fundraising for our group, and I've heard one person come up to us and say, I think this is a good idea. Everyone else says, what are you guys doing to stop it? What can we do to help you? How can we stop this? The last thing that I just want to say is that there's been a lot of speculation, especially in this room, about what the mining company thinks, what their interests are, where they're going. They have every opportunity to come up here and speak. There's nothing holding them back. There's nothing stopping them. And so what I'd like to say is, rather than, you know, working on speculation, supposition, if they want to come represent their interests, if they want to represent why they think this is needed, then they have that opportunity. And
thank you.
Because that's 3 minutes, I'll stop. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wayne Hendricks.
Good evening. Thank you. Wayne Hendricks, 1322 Kilwa Street, Burlington. My background includes 45 years of construction and development in all facets of the industry. What I'm here to talk about is the public-private partnership. One way of financing these schools and looking at the way of doing it. There was a bill called HB 857 was enacted August 23rd, 2013, which is entitled An Act Authorizing Public Contracts to Utilize Design-Build Method and Public-Private Partnership Construction Contracts, drastically expanding the available project delivery methods and financing options for public entities in North Carolina. Three of them is public-private partnerships, design-build contracts, and design-build bridging. A public-private partnership is an agreement between government agency and a consortium of private industry companies to build a new school or rebuild an existing school. The agreement is a single or multiple long-term contracts, usually for 2 to 25 years or longer. Financing comes partly from the private sector, but requires payments from the public sector and or users over the project's lifetime, just like making a mortgage payment on your home. Reason to use this form of financing: a city government, for example, might be heavily indebted and unable to undertake a capital intensive building project, but a private enterprise might be interested in funding its construction in exchange for receiving monthly, quarterly, yearly negotiated payments once the project is complete. Key takeaways: the infrastructure is difficult for the public sector to get right. Public-private partnerships can help. They can provide more efficient procurement, focus on consumer satisfaction, lifecycle maintenance, and provide new sources of investment. Public-private partnerships allow large-scale government projects such as schools, school renovations, to be completed with private funding and design. These partnerships work well with private sector technology innovation combined with public sector incentives to complete work on time and within budget. The government still owns the land and buildings. The principal board of trustees are responsible for the education matters. Because it does not deal with property and maintenance issues, the board of trustees, a PPP school, has more time to focus on education. They have used this process in Greenville County, South Carolina. And I'll leave you a copy because I couldn't read on 3 minutes.
You did a good job.
Thank you, copy.
Thank you, Wayne. I appreciate it.
Thanks, Wayne. Okay, the next speaker is Henry Vines.
Good afternoon, commissioners. My name is Henry Vines, and I'm from Snow Camp. I come tonight to talk to you. I see on the agenda that the proposal to adopt the budget tonight, and also
farmland preservation.
No, the capital plan improvements.
Taking a guess.
What I would like to bring tonight is that this is one of the most aggressive increases that this county has ever seen. And we're sitting here with a group of conservative representatives on this board. In 2018 budget, our budget was $151,600,000. We increased that budget this year to $152,279,000, which is a modest increase of about $400,000. We're jumping from that $152,279 to $171,681, a 12% increase, $20 million of taxpayers' money, additional money that's being spent over last year. I think that's pretty aggressive. I know there's a lot of things that need to be done. I know the $10 million of that is going toward the school bonds. But where's the rest of it, you know, and why are we have to be so aggressive in this proposal? The other thing I would like to bring to attention is on the revenue side of it. All right, we have projected a 10% increase in sales tax. Pretty aggressive increase over what we done last year. We're also increasing about a 9% increase in property taxes. That 9% is just, I'm not talking about for the bonds, I'm talking about the 9% increase just for our regular budget. And also in that budget, it's almost $6 million out of the fund balance. Folks, this is a reoccurring bill that we're gonna have each and every year from this point on. And from anywhere from 15 to 20 years when these bonds are done, we're increasing our debt another $1.5 million over what we've already got with the equipment that's being proposed and borrowing the money instead of paying for it. I know y'all got a tough decision to make tonight, and I just hope that y'all look at this and just see why we have to be this aggressive. $20 million increase is one of the biggest increases I've ever seen, and I've watched this a long time. Thank you for your time.
Okay, Mr. Vines was our last speaker, so do we have any commissioner responses?
I think we'll talk about them as we go.
Well, I was down in snow camp last week, and I will say signs are everywhere. I will tell you that for sure. Every time I turned around, there was another sign. You guys have done a good job getting your message out.
Okay.
What's the status of the resolution that passed on tonight? Is it up to be voted on?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
On the agenda. So if there's no further responses, then we move on with the approval of the agenda.
Let me just make one other comment. I just hope the rest of the citizens of Alamance County take a hard look at what we're dealing with right now with this mine issue and recognize that we're not isolated any longer. We're experiencing pressure from every corner to grow different businesses, different ideas all over the county. And if we don't do a land planning process, which we've been talking about, and if the citizens don't get behind it, anybody anywhere in Alamance County is subject to dealing with what the folks in Snow Camp are dealing with right now. We need to have a plan.
Good point. Okay, so next on the agenda would be approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the agenda. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Next is approval of the consent agenda.
Make a motion to approve.
Sorry. I'd like to pull out of state travel, please. B.
I was going to say the same thing.
All three of them or just
all three?
All three.
Okay, we have a motion. So we have a motion to amend the consent agenda to pull out the out-of-state travel. We have a motion and a second.
And a second.
To do that, all in favor of pulling out item B from the consent agenda, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? And we will, let's see, should we, let's approve the rest of the consent agenda, and then we'll do that part.
I move that we approve everything but number three. Number B.
B.
Okay.
Number B.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the rest of the consent agenda as amended. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, so let's go ahead and do that. The out-of-state travel, those items. Was there one in particular that you had a concern
Well, my
about?
Concern is, and it's not targeted at social services, but the overall process. Years ago, we questioned out-of-state travel, big time. And we created a policy of what was being spent, how to spend it, whether you spent the night or not, so forth and so on. And, you know, it came out even then that these conferences that people have, and this happened to be with social services, in all honesty, but it was grant money, but that's still tax dollars, that they were telling you to bring 10 people. Not bring one, not bring two, but bring 10. It was obvious that it was to be snowballed up to where they had a big conference, whatever. So we created a different policy, and I don't know that we watched it very closely. But the last meeting, I asked for a rundown of out-of-state travel, and we were given an email. Text rather, yeah, email, I guess, from Brian that year to date was approaching $300,000 in out of state travel. Is that not correct?
So, as of right now, the county has spent $195,616 on training so far this fiscal year. I think what we reported to the board was $145,571 of that was spent on mandatory or required trainings for staff. $50,045 was spent on non-mandatory trainings. I think the total budget for training across all the county government was around $288,000.
Right, well, it was going to hit
$300,000.
Yeah. Right, yeah. To me, that just blows my mind. And it's stated, it's ironic to have tonight's point in case versus what the analogy was there in the generalization of majority of it was being required. We've got three requests here. And unless I've just misread something, the three total, about $15,000, almost $15,000, they're going to Chattanooga, New Orleans, Atlanta, and none of it's required. None of it's for certification. Is that correct?
Maybe, is Adrian Day here?
A couple of them.
The DSS director?
I believe so.
One of them.
The obligated grant stuff.
I hear that, yeah. Still tax dollars.
The second one, yeah, they got a grant. As a condition of the grant, they have to go.
I guess they can get the grant back.
I think we need to not take those grants. They're going to cost 90,000 people to go on a trip.
So,
and even nine.
Adrian, would you mind explaining to us what the travel requests are, starting with the first one? Looks like it's for the fraud investigator to go to Chattanooga, Tennessee.
It is. It is a conference for Kelly Drogue. And this is a position that does not have opportunities for in-state training. And so that's the reason why we submitted that for her, because it gives her an opportunity to receive some additional training.
Was that grant money or was that tax, local tax dollars?
So this is, we use incentive money for that. So. So her trip would come out of the incentive funds for recouping money.
But local tax dollars, right?
She's a fraud investigator.
She is a fraud investigator,
so
yes.
So she gets, the more fraud she uncovers, then she gets incentives, or
that
the county
correct.
Gets incentives for that.
That is correct.
So it kind of comes out of the fraud.
Mm-hmm. For recouping that money, yes.
Okay, I understand. All right.
And then what about the next one? Or I'm sorry, I don't
no,
need
fine.
To cut
I'm
off
fine. I'm
discussion.
Yeah, I'm okay with that one.
Go back up.
And I apologize. One at a time or all together?
Yeah, one at a time.
Well, if somebody wants to go ahead and make a motion to approve that, if they're
I'll make a motion we approve that one.
I'll second it. That particular one.
Right. So this would be a motion and a second to approve the out-of-state travel request for the fraud investigator to attend the training conference in Chattanooga, Tennessee. We have a motion and a second to approve that request. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right, so the next one has to do with
NC
I'll
Shift.
I'll let you explain what this thing is, because I had some concerns about it.
So it's NC Shift, and it's a grant that we have. It's through the state, and it's to promote healthy teen sexuality. And so we actually have a facilitator, and then we have staff who are actually learning this program to be able to facilitate this program to our teens. It's open to not only our teens here in Alamance County, but any teen who is placed in Alamance, who's in foster care in the state of North Carolina, but are placed in Alamance County. They can actually come and receive this training as well.
How many people are going?
So with this one, we have, so Mary Shaw, she's going to be a trainer. So she's actually going to be able to train the trainers to be able to bring this back. So in case we need other trainers, she's able to train them. So she's learning the curriculum. And then we have three social workers who are going. And then the supervisor, she actually manages that program. She's a program manager. She manages this program.
Don't you have a bunch of children to go to?
No, we have no children. That's the next one.
Okay.
Now, is this paid for by the grant?
It is. It's completely paid.
So this is grant money in, grant money out.
That's correct.
And it's a requirement of the grant, right?
It is, particularly for Mary, who's actually going to be able to bring this training back. Yes.
I'll make a motion that we approve this
one. I'll second that.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve this travel request. Is there any more discussion?
Is that to New Orleans?
This is New Orleans. If there's no more discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, and the third one is for the annual Youth Link summer trip.
Yes, that's for our children who participate in our Links program, which is a program that tries to enhance our children who are leaving foster care. So equip them with skills. If you'll see here, the objective would be for them to gain some financial literacy, enhance their support network, and avoid risky behaviors. And so in order to put these trips together, this has to be approved by the state because it has to meet certain goals. And so some of it is, it's small, but it's big for our children who we serve. So these children are able to get an allowance. So it is about them being able to budget their money, understanding that if they have $20 a day, they can't spend $18 on breakfast. So it's about that, but it's also about making good choices, and it's about adding some educational component with that. And we typically take a trip like this once a year with our children who have participated in our Links program for the whole year.
Is this covered by a grant?
How many is going on that?
So for this one, I hate I didn't print
12,
this out.
12 youth.
They're, I was trying to find it, I apologize.
You probably can't name the children either, can you?
I cannot.
No, I don't really know.
How many?
Four social workers and 12.
12 youth and?
Four social workers.
Four social workers.
Yes, there are 16 total going, yes.
Did you say it is or isn't from a grant?
So it's not from a grant. It's state funds, but it's reimbursed through state funds.
Okay.
So county pays,
so it's
gets reimbursed.
Funds.
No.
It's still tax money.
Right.
Right.
I'm going to make a motion. We deny that.
Well, I'm going to be honest about it. I'm not trying to shoot down anything that you're doing. And those were, in my opinion, probably not the norm for our travel, in my opinion, across the board for our county. Again, I don't see how in the world we spend $300,000 for certification, conferences, and again, proof that they want us to send as many people as we can to a lot of the conferences, just for them to have a big conference at taxpayer expense. So I'm going to support, I'm a bit surprised, I'm going to support that, but I think we've got to study as hard as we can what we're doing with travel. And I'm not trying to shoot down the training for the sheriff's department or the training for any department at all, but I find it hard to believe. I mean, people make money on these conferences. I mean, it's out there for, I just like the grant, the SAMHSA grant you got?
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah, that's the grant where they were just saying bring as many people as you could. They want you to bring 10 people. They named 10, you had to bring 10 people. That's absurd. I don't care if it is grant money.
And it's very clear in the grant application who you have to bring to those conferences.
So, you know, I'm just trying to make a point that we need to really look at travel, keep a fine tune. I've been on this board for 23 years. I've never been on one trip that y'all paid expenses for that I know of. That I know of. Spend the night. That I know of. I went to one meeting. When I was with the bank, and they paid for it when I went to the bank. So I made them money. But, yeah, I just think it's out of hand, frankly. So I'm not trying to hurt you or anybody that needs training. But, you know, I don't know why we can't look at where you send one person, they come back and tell 50 or come back and tell 10, whatever. But that's why I'm only trying to make a point. Okay. Sorry you were the.
That's okay.
You just happened to be the one.
Yeah.
Well, Commissioner Matt Lashley has made a motion to deny the request. Is there a second? If there's not, then the motion fails for lack of a second. Does anybody have another motion to make?
I'll make a motion that we approve it.
I'll second it.
We have a motion and a second to approve the Link summer trip travel request. Is there any more discussion? And I'll say that Mr. Sutton's point's well taken. I think that it's important and relevant that
and
the out-of-state travel is
well scrutinized.
Maybe
that needs to be considered when you go for a grant. I mean.
Well, when we changed the policy, that's how the questions came about. Is it for certification or not? Is it local? Can it be done in state or not? That's how it all got on the form, or the form that we're using is when we first looked at it. So I'm not sure that we don't need to sift
it. Well, when they apply for the grant, it tells you requirements
up front.
So that's
that.
Where it needs to be.
Yeah, but when we had local travel that wasn't grant related and had to come out of the back pockets of the taxpayers of this county, we weren't asking enough questions. And we did get some more questions put on the form that I just reiterate. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure we are looking at them close enough.
We look at $288,000 for travel, how much of that is passed through, paid from outside sources?
Well, we know about grants, but
I think when we looked at this, the Sheriff's Department, DSS, and IT were the top three, I believe that's correct, receivers of funds for training. All of them have pretty significant training needs, so a lot of those funds come there. Some of it is from grants. Some of it is from
state funding.
Some state funding that the Sheriff's Department qualifies for. Some of it is part of new software implementation if IT is doing that. So, but I can assure you we'll be taking a harder look at before folks apply for grants, making sure we have a better understanding of what the travel requirements are. And when the department heads present information to the board requesting to be able to apply for a grant, we can have them explain that too, that there's going to be a piece of this that requires a certain amount of travel. So the board knows that when you approve the grant. That way it's very clear that in order to get this grant, we have to send five people to Chattanooga. You know that, so when it comes back before you for approval, you've already heard it.
As long as we know that, I'm okay with that.
Yes.
Before the time to vote.
Yes. I think if that's made clear to the board before application is made for the grant, that gives you a chance to tell us if you feel uncomfortable with that much travel. So.
Great. And this does look like a good opportunity for these foster children who are emerging into mm-hmm. adulthood to have some quality time with their peers and with mentors.
Tough time in their life.
Set right? their feet on a good yeah. path. So we have a motion and a second to approve that travel request. There's no further discussion. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
No.
Okay. So next on our agenda is consideration of adoption of the Alamance County Capital Plan.
And I've got a PowerPoint to go through with you. This will be familiar information, but considering the scope of this plan and the fact that we haven't had a bona fide full-blown capital plan in quite some time, I thought it was worth revisiting this data with you as we talk about this plan. And pass that I'm here this evening, commissioners, to present to you the proposed Alamance County capital plan for your adoption. I would be asking for you to vote to approve this plan. County staff have worked on this internally, along with our partners at Alamance Department School System and the Community College and our court system folks and department heads for almost 2 years. The school system and community college bond was one of the major driving factors behind putting this plan together. And the plan that you have in your packet is configured for the scenario that's in the manager's recommended budget. So I'm going to go through information that you've seen almost all this before, but I'm going to go through it for you and then try to answer any questions that you have about the capital plan. Please understand that this plan represents all of Alamance County's capital responsibilities. County government, criminal justice system, and education are all represented in this plan. So I'll do a run through, and if you have questions as I go through slides, please stop me, or we can talk about it at the end. So what does our capital plan do? It separates capital planning from operations. We've done that this year for the first time. We've taken the capital piece completely out of operational budget. It puts all of our capital responsibilities in one place. As I said, county government, criminal justice system, and education. The county's responsible for all those things. And we've used this planning process to establish our timelines for debt. You've heard us talk about this many times, about proposed bonds and projects and how we will pay for them, as well as our capacity for future debt. And we hope that this plan and this process demonstrates to the commissioners, to the Board of Education and the trustees, and to all the public that we are trying to address the capital needs, particularly the ones that have been made clear to us through the recent referendum for the bond. So for Alamance County, the Alamance County government piece of the capital plan, this includes county government buildings and the criminal justice system buildings. There is no property tax increase proposed for county facilities. The county is using its own debt step down and our own capital reserves to take care of county government buildings and criminal justice buildings. We are freezing our funding at 18-19 levels in the capital plan every year. So from county government's perspective, we are, over the next 7 years, proposing to have $250,000 a year for capital projects for county government. That's what we've had this year, and for the past several years, $250,000. We're looking at a seven-year project period in the plan. Are all the projects that we know of on a timeline each year for 7 years at $250,000 a year. Our facility plan has recently been completed, so we also are going to have the capacity in this capital plan to borrow $5 million to do some immediate need projects that we need to take care of. We'll do that in 2020 if the board's approving of that. And then we also have capacity without raising property taxes to borrow another $15 million of debt between the years 22 and 25 to develop our new facility plan. You know, we went over some of the new buildings that we've talked about building, how we could do that over on the court property in particular and start freeing up space. All of that, according to the plan, and as shown in the plan, can be done without a property tax increase for county government's needs. Now for the community college, in the capital plan, you have all the community college bond projects, and they're all laid out in there on the timelines that we've worked with the community college to establish. In order to try to keep the property tax rate impact low, as you've heard me say before, we're using community college debt step down, some capital reserves. We're also freezing the county's funding
for the community college projects at 18-19 level. And we do propose in the manager's recommended budget a 1.4 cent property tax increase that would be effective in fiscal year 19-20, specifically for the community college. So community college would get it through this capital plan, all the bond projects that they have proposed that were in the referendum on the timelines that we've all discussed, as well as the following dollar amounts each year for CIP. So they have needs besides their their bond projects. So every year for a 7-year period, you see the dollar amounts that would be provided to the community college going from next fiscal year, $870,000, to fiscal year 25-26, the plan would call for the community college to get $280,000. That is money in addition to what the bonds would pay for. This is the dollars that we give them every year. I believe in 18-19, we budgeted $440,000 to give the community. So the college does begin to build some capital reserves in 25-26, and based on the debt, if we issue debt for bonds, and those capital reserve funds could be used for future debt or some kind of an emergency. But we would keep it all in the capital plan in the capital reserve for the community college. Then for the school system, the plan that's proposed before you this evening, all the bond projects are in that plan, all the ones that were on the referendum, all of the same timelines that we've discussed with the school system and the school system believes are appropriate. And we are using in the capital plan debt step down that we currently pay for the school system stays with their projects, as well as our capital reserves. Lottery funds will be used to help pay for the school system's piece of the capital plan, as well as the sales tax funds that are specifically required by state law that have to be spent for school capital. They're accounted for in the capital plan, as well as new property tax revenue. The recommended budget that you have also to think about this evening does recommend a 5.64 property tax rate increase specifically for the school system, specifically for their capital needs. So in the capital plan and in the manager's recommended budget, the plan calls for the school system to also receive $3.3 million every year for CIP projects, just like the county and the community college. The school system has capital needs that are not in the bond projects that are approved by referendum. So every year for a 7-year planning period, the school system would receive $3.3 million to work on those projects also. And as with the community college, they start to build capital reserves in 25-26 that they can they could use for emergencies or to enhance CIP project. So a few things to think about as you think about approving this capital plan, as you think about the budget that's also before you this evening. In our capital plan, we have budgeted articles, the sales tax revenue is budgeted conservatively. That was done, this is debt. This is not operating budget. So in our operating budget, if sales tax start dropping off, we can make adjustments. We can start drawing back on programs that we offer. Once we issue this debt, if sales tax starts going down, we can't do that. We got to pay that debt payment. So we're being conservative with our sales tax revenue in the event this is a 20-year horizon. There will be downturns over this time period. We've also figured the lottery revenues conservatively. Both of these revenues, sales tax and lottery, are more volatile than your property tax.
Right.
They're dependent on the economy. Both of them are. So we figured them both conservatively. That is the same method we've used all through this planning process. And another thing to think about for the future would be revisiting Article 46 sales tax. Right now, those dollars are not in the capital plan. The voters did not approve that at the last vote. But the dollars that we figured an Article 46 sales tax would create was an additional $4.8 million annually. So the board may want to consider as early as the spring at the primary the possibility of putting that back on the ballot. And we also have several measures that are in the Senate and the House that deal with school capital bonds. They are not in place right now, and we're looking at what we're about to start doing. But the school capital bonds may come along, and I think they're looking at two different formats. And we also need to bear in mind the future operating costs for the new school system and community college buildings. We will have future budgets that will have to accommodate the operating costs of a new high school in particular, and also with the community college, they have several new buildings that will be coming online. So those will be things staff will certainly be thinking about. So what I would say to you that is important for this capital plan to succeed, and I think we have gone a long ways down these roads over the past 2 years, is we, the county staff, need to be dedicated to planning for capital and monitoring the status of projects. And we mentioned this TRC, this Technical Review Committee, that consists of county staff, school system leadership, and community college leadership. We meet every week, every Tuesday, to talk about where we are in capital planning. I would certainly suggest that that would continue, and that helps, from a county perspective, that helps us stay plugged into their needs and what progress they're making. We also believe that it'll be critical, as I've said before, that the school system and the community college put people in place to actively monitor bond projects on the ground, making sure that timelines are being met and change orders are accurate and those kind of things. So what I would recommend that you consider this evening is the adoption of this plan, and it would take, we would like to have a vote. It would become a part of our budget process every year. Every year, the manager should be bringing you this plan. We will amend it as we go throughout the year. Things change, we'll make changes to it, but every year at budget time, we would bring this plan back to you. So at this time, if you have any questions about the plan or any of its contents, I'd be happy to try to answer them.
I don't know if it's as much a question as it is a thought, but I've been thinking about this a lot, and some of us have been talking about it. If we're going to stay as a county government in downtown Graham, we've got to prepare for the growth that's coming to us. The footprint we're looking at, once it's filled out, is pretty constricted. Can't go anywhere without having more land. The other option is to go out in the county, but then we're junking a lot of what we already have and leaving downtown Graham, like Burlington kind of got left when LabCorp pulled out. So one of the things I'd recommend that we look at is the land along Elm, between Elm and I'm not sure what the street is it backs up to. As it comes available, or even go into the degree of optioning some of that land to have space to grow west of where the courthouse and the jail are now. Because if we don't, we're going to be at some point where what we've got is all we've got, and we've got to go someplace else to do it all over again.
Well, I do think it's wise to plan for future growth, you know, 20, 30, 40 years from now, based on the way the county population is growing. I suspect we will see growth in the need for criminal justice facilities, the need for, I think, criminal justice facilities in particular, because, you know, the court system, we hear rumors about projected growth. We're already seeing some of that now as the state makes changes to the number of juvenile justice folks that need to be hired here. So as the county grows, our need for that kind of elbow room will grow also. So it's a wise consideration to keep in mind, indeed.
It is, and it's also important to remember that that's where the jail is, and it's really expensive to build a new jail.
Right.
We don't want to have to do that, so we have to really look at that footprint closely.
And I think that's one thing we saw through our facility planning process, that when it comes to the jail, it is expensive and a very specialized space, that in the future, add on to it and take advantage of the infrastructure that's already there, your kitchen, your laundry, the courts, those kind of things. It is cost-saving to make use of the existing facilities as much as possible.
I have a little question about slide number 9, where you talk about the sales tax revenues are estimated conservatively and the lottery revenues are estimated conservatively. If those figures come in above estimates, what happens to the extra money? Do they go to the school system on top of what they're getting by law, or would they go into our general fund because we have an agreement?
So the Article 42 and 40 revenues are specifically for school capital, so they would need to be put into the capital plan. What we have talked about is those would be in capital reserve. So we would keep the school system appraised of if sales tax in those two articles are coming in higher. The lottery funding is also by law theirs, and so we would put it in the capital reserve too. And again, I think one thing that we have brought away from this process is a much better and more open communication with the school system leadership. It's in their best interest for us to keep them appraised as the dollars come in. So
But one of the things I've heard too is over and over again, people are telling me they wish they had known, and I don't know how they didn't, seriously. They wish they had known what the impact would be on the property tax if they didn't vote for the sales tax. So I think there's going to be, I'm already hearing pressure to see the sales tax come back on the ballot.
My discussion with Ms. Holland at the Board of Elections has been that if the commissioners are interested in taking a look at that again for primary in the spring by November, she would need to know that, and we'd have to have some language worked up with Mr. Albright as we did last time. And there are some bills that are pending at the state level that will make some language available on the ballot, some limited language on the ballot that will tell the voters what these funds are for.
Yes,
we've talked about that before, about maybe folks when they voted, they didn't understand at the moment what their vote was. They just saw this was a new sales tax. My understanding is there's been some legislation floated that would at least allow the ballot to say this is for education purposes. So maybe people would make a better informed choice when they go in the ballot box.
So the tax impact of 7.04 cents together is the ACC bond plus the ABSS bond, and that's what the capital plan is.
Yes.
That's what the 7.04 is.
It is their, it's their bonds and their PAYGO, their CIP. Yes. The county piece is in the plan, but we have configured it in such a way that we are not proposing a tax increase for the county to do the $250,000 a year for the next 7 years or borrow. The county has the capacity without raising taxes to borrow $20 million to do repair work and the new construction that we've talked about.
First of all, on the sales tax putting on in May versus general election, I think there's always been a ploy to do the primaries because less people show up and the percentages are lower of turnout, and it's usually more agenda-driven. So I would be in support of a general election, but not necessarily the primary.
I believe there's also a pending legislation that would prevent the county from doing it twice in 1 year. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if that's passed, but the idea being if you did it in the primary and it failed, you would not be able to do it again in November. So that would certainly be something for the board to discuss.
Yeah, something to vote on.
Yes.
Down at the bottom, tax bill.
Down at the bottom, you got future operating costs for ABSS and ACC. Are we not projecting that that's going to run over a penny on the tax rate?
The operation costs for the new high school have been estimated at $1.5 million. That'll be a new annual cost. The community college, I want to say, was around $500,000, $400,000 to $500,000for their buildings that they'll be adding. So you would be looking at, we would be looking at, close to $2 million a year annually in new operating costs for all the new construction. Now, they, school system didn't feel it would really add to the operating costs for the renovation work that they're doing in most of the buildings. It's really the new high school is the primary driver on that. And that will be something that we will face. I think the new high school is scheduled to come online in 2023. So in a number of years, we'll be facing having to fund that operational cost too.
I wouldn't be surprised if that wouldn't be about a penny at that point. I don't know where we're growing.
Does anybody want to make a motion?
I'll make a motion that we approve the capital plan.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to adopt the Alamance County capital plan. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay. Next on our item is the budget ordinance. Is everybody okay to continue? Does anybody need a break?
Well, I'm okay.
Okay, as we get started with this, before Mr. Haygood presents whatever he wants to present, I just wanted to sort of shape this, because we've talked about a few different changes with respect to the manager's recommended budget. We talked about the SROs, adding SRO positions. We've talked about farmland preservation and adding a part-time library position. We talked about the fraud investigator for DSS, and I think that Commissioner Carter has a motion that he wants to make with regard to the rescue squad.
I do. I've talked with the guys at the rescue squad and had some questions raised about the the way their budget breaks down, $150,000 for capital and $50,000 for operations. They really can't make it on $50,000 for operations. We took $50,000 out and added it to capital, and that will not work for them. They also will not have that ambulance available, or not the ambulance, excuse me, the trash truck won't be available for about a year. So what I'm making a motion, we change that item to $100,000 for operations and $100,000 to capital.
And what would be the net impact on the manager's recommended budget?
None.
So it's the same dollar amount.
Same dollar amount, just to changing the places.
Slicing it up a little
differently. Right.
$100,000 for rescue for operations.
And it's quite possible by the time that crash truck is ready, that $100,000 could be used as a down payment as opposed to a payment and could reduce our debt service. I'll make that motion.
Okay, so is there a second? I'll second it.
Well, I don't have an objection to doing what you want to do, but is it proper to do motions for
within
the budget ordinance, yeah, you know, as far as telling you what the final rate is going to be and what we'd like to see done?
Well, I think it would be helpful for us if the board wants to make changes to the manager's recommended budget. If you are willing to do that one at a time as a motion, that's very helpful for us to be able to track it and make sure we totally understand any changes that you're making. So whether you approve a tax rate first or you all agree that you think a change to the budget that Commissioner Carter's talking about where it doesn't have an impact on you don't need to find more money, from our perspective, that's fine to do. As long if you will continue to do that one motion at a time, we can track it, and then you can still have time to approve a final rate. If you, yes, yeah, so I think.
That has been kind of okay. My vision, that's that we good. Would change it and then approve the final recommended budget with the rate.
Just make sure 2 + 2 = 4.
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Or does it? Anymore.
So Mr. Carter made a motion to change the allocation to Alamance County Rescue with the same net allocation to them, and I seconded it. Is there any more discussion about that? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? So we have the county manager's recommended budget with that one alteration so far.
Yes.
So if anybody else has, you know, I don't know if you have a presentation that you wanted to make.
No, I think.
I think we've presented.
Yes. So you have the recommended budget presented May 6th, now amended. We've had our public hearing at Cummins back on May 20th. So at this point, I'll certainly try to answer any questions that the board have. But we're here now to just basically answer your questions and help as
so
we can.
So would it help you if we made a motion to do what Mr. Bale asked on the farmland preservation?
So the commissioners did ask me at the last meeting to prepare some things to consider about several positions as well as farmland preservation. So I think I've shared with you all a couple of scenarios. I think the one that Mr. Bell was talking about, what we were able to determine after working with the library director and the sheriff and the director of social services is that the library part-time position for North Park, the library director has assured me that she can find those funds within the budget that has been recommended. So right. The dollars that you have for libraries, she can make that work. The sheriff has said that with the new increase of funding from the ABSS, he can, along with moving a little bit of money already budgeted for him, he can make the three new school resource officers work within his existing budget.
Good.
So no new money's added.
Good.
And the Department of Social Services has indicated that for their fraud investigator position, they would be able to use what they project as lap salaries for next year to be able to hire the fraud investigator without having new dollars. So those positions, part-time library position, three new SROs, and the fraud investigator, all departments have said they can handle that with no new dollars. And then, as Mr. Bell mentioned, the option one that I gave the commissioners to consider is adding $50,000 to farmland preservation, which would give a total of $150,000 next fiscal year for farmland
preservation, as well as approving $62,415 for the salary and benefit costs of one new planner two position. This would be a new person in our planning department. So that's new spending, and you can see in the scenario that the way we've proposed to pay for that without having to add more money into the budget, we would reduce contingency by $57,200. We would reduce the county manager's office training budget by $4,000. We would not hire the planner two until August 1. So we would go ahead and post that and make all the arrangements, but not actually bring that person in. And really, we don't think we would be hiring someone until that time anyway. By the time we advertise, we hope to get someone that will come to us from a county, maybe a county that has some land use regulation experience and can help us out, as Tanya did. So we would save $5,215 by not hiring the planner two until August 1. And then the last piece of this proposal to try to make this work financially is to budget $46,000 that are currently, they're actually occupancy tax dollars. We have $90,525 in occupancy tax surplus that we collected in 17-18.
How much?
$90,525. So we make a projection of occupancy tax dollars and do a budget based off that projection. We hold any additional money from the occupancy tax that comes in because we also have to make sure that we actually get all the occupancy tax that we've projected. So we have $90,525 in surplus right now. What I would suggest that we do is use $46,000 of that to offset the current proposed Parks Department budget. This is legal by statute. We can use occupancy tax to offset the operation of parks. So that would free up $46,000 in general fund monies that we would put toward the planning department to help pay for this position. So it's a little bit of maneuvering money internally, but the idea was to try to find a way. How do you put more money in farmland preservation? How would you hire a new planner and do it in such a way that we wouldn't have to find more outside revenues? This is maintaining parks as a legal use of occupancy tax, and any remaining occupancy tax surplus after the fiscal year 18-19 closes would be divided among the folks that get occupancy tax dollars now. That's our intent. We hold that money to make sure we have enough. So.
Do you need a motion?
Well, I think part of if the commissioners are interested in amending the recommended budget this way, okay, then yes.
To incorporate those changes.
I move that we do that.
Okay.
I'll second it.
Is that a motion and a second to make sure we got it all straight, to add the new part-time position for North Park Library to take care of the three new full-time school resource officer positions, to add the full-time fraud investigator position, all of those having zero net impact on the budget, as well as increase farmland preservation by $50,000 and add a new planner two position to the planning department. Yep. That's
right,
your motion?
Okay. That's my motion.
And the second?
We got all that soon.
Okay. Is there any discussion about that? If there's not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay. Does anybody have any more motions to amend the county manager's recommended budget? Recommended budget.
I'd like for there to be a little discussion about, you know, years ago, did they pass a law that you had to quote what revenue neutral rate was? They passed a law. And because a lot of people were avoiding that quote. And I think Kerry Allred was the first one that really raised Cain over. And well, he should have. And so I asked Brian to give us we hadn't even heard the word revenue neutral in this process that I know of this year. And so I asked Brian just last week, 1 week before we were supposed to vote on this, what revenue neutral was. And I think your quote was 56.64.
That's correct.
So we're at 59. Is that not correct?
That's correct.
That's what we're at. So unless I'm just, never was real good at math, to be honest about it, but, you know, if we're at 59, or you know, theoretically we could be at 56.64 if we were revenue neutral and weren't financing the bonds, which is what we obviously got to do, and what increases you want for whatever. Am I correct in thinking you want to go to 67, right? That the tax rate increase above revenue neutral is over, it's pushing 11 cents. Is that not, am I analyzing that correct?
Sure. Yes.
Yep, we told the public that we weren't going to raise rates but 7 cents to take care of it and so forth and so on. Now, I'm sorry, I just see smoke and mirrors at times in this process. What shell the peas under at times in this process. It really bothers me greatly. Greatly. I support the new high school. I support the improvements. I was on the school facility committee when I looked at them, and I was embarrassed. You know, kids bouncing off each other going down. Of course, that's not nothing unusual. I mean, I see that in Greensboro all the time. 2,000 kids coming down the hall when the bell rings. Y'all see it. And a highly funded system. But I'm bothered by a lot of the rhetoric here that we don't talk about what revenue we didn't. I mean, the word revenue neutral would not have even surfaced that I know of, except for what happened, me asking about it last week.
Certainly. Yes, we usually only disclose that at revile. Wow. But I think we've tried to help the board understand that we experience natural base growth. And that's where, you know, you pick up significant revenue just because we are blessed to live in a county that has a good economy and is growing.
I'm saying that. But you still have, by law, for a reason, the directive to, quote, revenue neutral.
I'm not sure if that's every year. My understanding is that is definitely for revile.
Well, it's my understanding is that. Well, I might be saying to be corrected on that.
Which I don't want to hide that from the board. And, in fact, if that's something that, you know, I think we express that by saying the base is growing, right? If the board wants to know, and we've talked about this since you asked that question, if expressing revenue neutral every year rather than just a revale is helpful for the commissioners, we're happy to do that. As I say, we're fortunate to live in a place that base does grow, sales tax is growing, we're in a good economy, and folks are building here. So I certainly don't want to come across as we're trying to keep that from the board. So.
Well, it wasn't hard to figure out.
No,
there was a percentage increase.
Yeah, well, the public doesn't understand the political. Like, we went down to Davidson County, me and the assistant county manager. They had a revale. It was during a revale, I will admit that, and that may be the law, and I may stand corrected on that. But I think in principle, it's not a bad idea to do it every year.
Sure.
But we went down, and they had a revale, and they didn't cut their taxes at all, period. And we looked at the assistant county manager and said, how'd you get by with that? He said, well, they don't understand what revenue neutral is. And I said, well, that'd burn our courthouse down if we didn't quote it here.
Sir.
So, but the net result is it appears that, well, let me ask this. Okay, if revenue neutral is at 57, just for the sake of figures, raise it up 0.36, but 57, and we're at 59, and you're going up to, you want to go up to 67, how much is financing the bonds really that in full increase except for one penny for what you're asking for?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yep. And that totals how much?
7.04 cents is what it would take to finance the bonds.
1.4.
Yeah, but don't you have the difference in what revenue neutral is involved as well?
I'm not sure I'm following your question. So.
Well, if you're at 57 revenue neutral and you're at 59 with our rate now, okay, but you raise rates to 67, right?
Yes. Revenue neutral all the way to 67 is incorporated into the manager's recommended budget.
Okay, I understand that. Yeah, I understand that. But how much of that is really just for the bonds?
So, if I'm not mistaken, the difference between where we are now at 59 cents and 56.64 was approximately $3.5 million. Mm-hmm. So if we cut out all the bonds and we cut out the county 0.96 cent for the capital plan for the county, if we took those away and went to revenue neutral, we'd have to cut an additional approximately $3.5 million from the recommended budget to make the budget work at 0.5664. Am I saying that correct? Okay.
And when Davenport, when they did that kind of projection, they were projecting that growth in there, weren't you, too?
Yeah, we had an FY20 value of a penny of about $1.4 million and needed, that's what we used to calculate the 7.04 pennies needed right. for the capital.
Well, I have a different concern that I would like to bring up, Mr. Sutton, if I don't want to cut you off.
No, I'm fine.
Interrupt you.
I just want to talk about revenue neutral.
And anyway, so this is totally separate from Mr. Sutton's concerns. I've been thinking about something since really about April 30th. And if y'all bear with me, I've written out some thoughts. So on May 1st, the North Carolina Association of Educators hosted a demonstration at the General Assembly in Raleigh, and some of the public school systems in North Carolina decided to close the schools for that day so that their local personnel could participate, and that's fine. That was their decision. Last year, in 2018, our school board and the superintendent we had at the time decided to close for the day. And that was fine. That was their decision. This year, Superintendent Benson and the ABSS school board decided not to close schools for the day. Some teachers scheduled to take leave and made plans to attend the demonstration, which was fine. And Dr. Benson and the school board did not see that there was a need to close the school system. ABSS families were told that the school would be open and to plan accordingly. And I personally support Dr. Benson and the school board for their leadership on that issue. I thought that the administration handled the situation well in showing that every day for school instruction is important. It was also important to remember that schools were closed several times over the school year because of weather, that end of course and AP exams were approaching, and that instructional time is important for student achievement. And I thought Dr. Benson and the school board showed common sense and foresight in their decision. Now, late in the day on April 30th, the day before the NCAE demonstration in Raleigh, some school bus drivers together announced that they would not be coming to work the next day. Not all school bus drivers participated in that decision, but enough did that the administration could not ensure that all children in ABSS would be safe in transporting to and from school. Because they could not guarantee the students' safety, the administration closed the school system for May 1st. Therefore, the school bus drivers forced the administration's hand, undermined the decision that had been made to keep the school system open, and by collective labor action, shut down our public school system for the day. Parents were left scrambling for childcare and other arrangements. There was a ripple effect in our community as people had to rearrange their lives at the last minute to account for the decision that the school bus drivers had made not to come to work the next day. And this has been on my mind ever since for a number of reasons. First, the school employees are paid with taxpayer money. On May 1st, thousands of people in Alamance County got up to go to work, to earn a paycheck, provide for themselves and their families, and to pay their taxes.
I'm sure that plenty of these workers would rather have taken the day off to pursue some other goal that they think is important. However, they showed up at work to do what they were supposed to do, what they had been hired to do, regardless of their feelings about it. That employees who earn their paycheck from the taxpayer would in turn refuse to show up for work in order to pursue a political objective is not acceptable. If you earn your living from money that was taken by law from someone else who did not have a choice but to pay it, and you do not show up for work because you have a political objective pursued, in my opinion, that is wrong and it is disrespectful to the taxpayer. Second, it was disrespectful to the families of ABSS who were left to scramble for other arrangements at the last minute. Although there may be some who say they didn't mind that the inconvenience to them was okay because they support the objectives of the demonstration, that is irrelevant. The fact is that a lot of people did mind, and the public should never be left wondering if its government is going to show up for work, or will it be shut down because the employees together decide that they are going to make a point. Third, the situation has been on my mind because I wonder what the future holds. I believe that the ABSS administration has been making plans for next year to be sure that if the bus drivers all call in to be absent, then there will be an alternative to get the children to school. However, what if the cafeteria workers decide to strike? What if the County Child Protective Service workers at DSS decided to close the office for the day because their professional association sponsored a political day in Raleigh? What about the county inspections office or the Veterans Affairs office for the county? For a county office to close for the day, for the taxpayers' work not to be done because county employees have decided to pursue political objectives, in my opinion, is not acceptable in any way, shape, or form. When someone from Alamance County goes to conduct business at a county office, he or she should be confident that the office will be open and county staff are available to address their concerns. Obviously, there are cases when people are sick or the weather is bad and the office has to be closed, and I'm not talking about those situations. I'm talking about when taxpayer employees, people employed by the taxpayer, decide independently that they have something better to do on a work day than to show up and do the work they were hired to do. Fourth, the fundamental disrespect that the organized strike by the bus drivers showed toward Dr. Benson and the school board really bothers me. Frankly, they essentially gave the administration the middle finger and undermined what the leadership had thoughtfully determined was the best course of action for the entire system. And I certainly understand that their action didn't meet the legal definition of a strike, but regardless, that's what it functionally was. Labor organized to shut down the employer because they had labor-related demands. That is a strike. In these circumstances, it was disrespectful and it was undermining. I would like for this board to have a discussion either tonight or sometime in the future about whether there is anything we can do as county commissioners to address this situation and prevent it from happening again. I think it's appropriate for this board to show its support of the superintendent and the school board by saying that if the school system employees together organize to work against a publicly announced decision, this board will find a consequence. The school system's total budget is over $215 million, I think, about $49 million, I think, of which comes from this county. So it is in our power tonight to cut their budget by some amount to send a signal that employee strikes and walkouts will not be tolerated by the Board of Commissioners. If we cut their budget by 0.5%, it would be less than $250,000. We could set that amount aside in our fund balance and restore it next year if there are no more employee strikes, walkouts, or organized labor acts. Now, the obvious problem with this idea is that it's not related to the bus drivers themselves. We don't have a scalpel in this situation. We just have a sledgehammer. It's punishing the entire school system for the actions of a relative few. And that's why I would be reluctant to make a motion like that to this effect this year. However, I think it's worth putting on the table, worth a discussion and consideration, that this is where we stand as a board on this issue. We will not tolerate organized labor actions by those who are paid by the taxpayer. We will not tolerate employees who undermine the decision makers. We will not tolerate employees who put their political agenda above the promises made to the community
when families have made their plans accordingly. So I personally am not willing to make that motion. I'm bringing up something to not make a motion to cut the school system's budget. And if somebody else makes it, then I'm not going to vote for it. But I think that it should be really clear that that's not acceptable, that we stand behind the superintendent and we stand behind the school board. And what they decide to do is what we support. And we are not looking to undermine them. And we want, we expect people who are paid by the taxpayer to show up for work unless there's a exigent circumstance like weather or illness. So I don't know.
I'll support you on that, Amy.
I'd have seconded it if you'd made it.
Me too.
I'm sorry that that was lengthy. Anybody else? No.
I've gotten a lot of comments about that. A lot of people were really upset.
Yeah, those bus drivers should have been fired, every one of them.
Reagan pulled that stunt, didn't
yeah.
he?
Just send them
air traffic controllers.
Well, I'm sure that the school system is doing what it can to address that situation, to keep it from happening again and dealing with it appropriately. I have total confidence in that. And I just, I think that it's good if we're on record that, you know, as a board.
We did notice it.
We remarked on it, and we do have the power to address it yeah. in some way, even if it's a ham-handed attempt. It would be ugly. So, okay, so that's, I'm done with that. Thank you for letting me get that off of my,
you feel better?
Out of my system. I've been stewing on that for 6 weeks. So.
I support you 100%.
There you go.
Thank you. Okay, so then we have had motions to amend the budget, which have been adopted. And so I guess it's time to either entertain another motion to amend the budget or a motion to adopt the budget as amended at y'all's pleasure.
I'll make a motion that we adopt the budget as amended.
Second.
Okay.
Now what are we voting on?
We're voting on the manager's recommended budget,
which is 6.767 cents.
Right.
Yes.
I can't support it that. It is the vote for the tax rate.
I cannot support that.
It is the vote for the tax rate?
He is,
okay.
Yes.
Okay. I have racked my soul and my brain as to what I was going to do with this. I've said all along I supported about everything everybody's wanting to do. But again, that phrase was about everything. That's not everything. Well, I think it's going to pass, so, you know, but I still want to say these words. Government doesn't seem to ever say, I don't need any more money. I'll take every dollar you'll give me. And I don't care what department it is. And it's not, I'm not hitting anybody other than to say overall. I didn't see much effort this whole year, this whole budget process, to be conservative with what you were asking for. That's my personal opinion. I could be wrong, but that's my opinion. Is there a way I can do it cheaper? Is it, you know, is there a way I can build this cheaper? Is it a way I can, you know, we're not even considering the fact that the state very well will approve a statewide bond referendum where the, well, I think we're going to get $25, $26 million possibly if that's approved. And I believe you can bet your best dollar that that'll be approved statewide. You know, I'm willing to play those odds. There's no doubt in my mind, looking at it from a business perspective, that all this could have been, everybody, basically, could, you know, especially what's driving the numbers up, the dollars up, could have been done cheaper. You know, I've seen things go from a certain amount of millions of dollars a level to a higher level. I remember a conversation, I'm almost positive I heard it, where somebody said, told the state, well, we don't need but $99 million, we don't need but $100 million, and then it goes to $150 million, and the conversation was, ask for more, don't lowball it, ask for more. And at least I'm pretty sure I heard that. I believe I heard that. But I said all along, based on what I was looking at across the board, and it's not a big deal here as far as numbers, but that I would support 66 cents, not 67. I saw 67 and was impressed by it, not gonna lie to you. But I said originally that I thought everybody could get basically what they want, basically, for 66. And we brought in somebody to, I'm not going to say cook the numbers. I think you did a very reputable job showing us what we should look at, could look at, and did look at. I don't know where the frugality was, if that's a good word, was put out there. I honestly don't. And, you've had already tonight estimates of a penny and a half for operational. I mean, we're headed to 70 cents so fast, it's going to make your head spin. People told me, no, you're crazy. I never thought I'd see this county be at that level. Not with the median incomes that we have, the jobs that are out there. And people could say, well, you'd raise it, and we'd build this, we'd do that. You'll get the jobs. I'm not going to support 67. I've said it from the very beginning, I would support 66. And what's a penny? What's a penny? Now, I'm not asking that. I know what a penny is.
Damn.
But
is that a motion?
Well, yeah. Let me finish that. Next thing you're at 68. You're at 69. You're at 70. Where does it stop? You guys are going to inherit, ladies, a good opportunity to either hold it or take it there. And I want to go off this board believing that I didn't take it there as much as I had the power to not take it there. Our budget doesn't need to be as high as it is in this county, in my opinion, for what we've got to show for it. And we got a lot to show for what we do have, but I think it could have been done cheaper. But anyway, yep, that's...
I got a question.
Yeah.
What were the original requests, Brian?
Let's see. I do have that information, but just bear with me for just a moment.
About 10 million more, I think, if I'm not mistaken.
The budget retreat. $168 million just for the general fund budget. That was county services were about $102 million.
So how much have we pared the original request down to where we are now? I know you and I have talked about it almost every line item in the budget. So
county government's original request totaled about $102 million. County government in the recommended budget is at $96.6 million. So to county government budget, we have made significant cuts. We have not pared down anything to the proposed bond. That is as
the voters voted on.
All projects are in both project listings, and I keep saying this on their time period, but that's important from the tax rate perspectives.
But I'll point out to you, Mr. Carter, that this is my 23rd budget. This is your first. And I have always seen that they asked for way more than they got. That's part of the game. That's part of the game.
John, I would think, being a Tea Party chairman, you would know that.
You don't think I've agonized over this?
Well, I'm just telling that. I mean, if you try to give an example that we have cut, that's sort of expected. But
I've tried to look at where we would cut $1,444,000 out of this budget.
For how much?
$1,444,000.
Well, I guarantee you it can be done.
Yeah, it can be done easily. It takes some of those.
But nobody wants to do it.
Some of these trips.
That's the whole key.
That they're teaching people to go on or for training that don't need to be done because it's not necessary. That's a good way to start doing it, a little bit at a time. But you get up here, you just got reelected. You ran as a conservative, vote that way.
Well, I don't want this to become an attack on anybody. Well, you go ahead. I love you, Bill. Yeah, I've already told Bill if I go first, he carries me. If he goes first, I carry him. But, you know, again, nobody, I won't say nobody, but the vast majority of the drivers of this budget, as far as the high numbers, in my opinion, didn't make as good effort as they could have to do it cheaper. And I think it's our responsibility to either make that decision or not. And I'm happy with my vote. And I'm not against the sheriff's department, not against schools, not against anybody. But
everybody can do it cheaper.
Yeah, it's the Cadillac versus the Chevrolet, maybe, or the Ford, whatever. But anyway, I'm okay with my vote. Y'all vote the way you want. I'm happy.
Do you have anything?
I love y'all.
All right, we have a motion and a second to approve the manager's recommended budget as amended. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed?
No.
Two noes. One no. Two noes.
Two noes.
So that concludes that item on the agenda, and let's have a 10-minute recess before we move forward.
Where are we at?
The next item on the agenda is a resolution to approve a lease purchase of Xerox equipment for the school system. Mr. Teeter.
Good evening, Chair Gailey, Commissioners, and Mr. Haygood. So before I jump into this, I just want to preface, we're not asking for new money. The school system has been with Toshiba for copiers for the last 12 years. The last couple of years, it's not been a good situation with the service and the quality of our equipment. So we put that out for bid this year. We had 7 responses. We narrowed it down to 2 companies we felt could handle the account. The teachers at Eastlawn Elementary, who've had a lot of copier trouble the past year or so, got to demo the 2 finalists and pick the machines that they would like. And so we're proposing to enter into a relationship with Xerox to replace our copiers and printers. The money we're currently spending on copiers and printers, we would dedicate to that. And because of the bid process that we went through, we're actually coming in cheaper on that solution. And so due to the length of the lease, it requires county commissioner approval before we enter into that. The language in this is very similar to what you would have seen just a couple of years ago for the teacher laptops. So very identical language, and again, no new money in order for us to replace those copiers.
I'll make a motion and we approve it.
I'll second that.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve that contract. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, Coble Sandrock Franchise Agreement. Mr. Hill. Or Mr. Walk.
I've been asked to translate. So this is the ordinance, a renewal, and that's why we pulled it out of the consent agenda so the public and you guys know it's a renewal of the ordinance granting a construction and demolition debris landfill franchise to the Coble Sandrock Incorporated. The ordinance is the 5th franchise renewal for Coble Sandrock, a family-owned landfill for construction and demolition debris off Foster Store Road outside Liberty. We, the county, legal, planning, landfill folks, management met with the Cobles. They're very nice folks. Their engineer from Joyce Engineering to review the agreement, update the dates, the numbers, and the maps. But essentially, it's the same agreement, just passing it forward for another 7 years. Renewals for 7 years has a dual $500,000 financial assurance policy, a gate rate of $33.50 per ton with a minimum charge of $15 per load. They pay a county host fee of $1 a ton of deposited material, They're required for all state and local ordinances. The signed agreement is required so this, before the state can proceed with their renewal process. And per ordinance rules, we have a second reading July 15th. The Cobles are here, Kent and Brenda Cole, and Leonard Joyce from Joyce Engineering. If you have any questions, we have folks here. I just found out from Terry that Kent and Terry used to play football together. So, anyway, if you have any questions.
Yep, they're running a good operation.
They sure do. Good operation. I'll move the will. Approve that.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve that franchise agreement. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, the next item of business is a Board of Trustees appointment to Alamance Community College. We had two people put in an application. One was Blake Williams, who's he is the current board representative to the ACC Board of Trustees. His term expires on June 30th, and he's applied for a reappointment. And then a second person, Dr. Dewey Carter, submitted an application to be considered for that appointment. So, and the applications were included in the agenda packet. And I'll make a motion to approve Blake Williams to be reappointed to the ACC Board of Trustees.
I'll second that one.
Is there any discussion? There's a motion and a second to approve Blake Williams' reappointment. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. Grant Project Ordinance. Susan Evans.
Good evening, Commissioners. Before you tonight is a resolution, a grant project ordinance for the board to adopt for our Family Justice Center grant. This is a multi-year grant, and by us moving it into a multi-year fund, we will be able to better track the expenses and make reporting easier for our Department of Social Services. With it being in our general fund, it's going back and forth across years, and this way we would be able to continue keeping it in one cost center in one fiscal year. And the grant was approved at a previous board meeting back in October for $756,177.87.
Do you need a motion?
Yes, sir.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve this grant project ordinance. Is there any discussion?
Out of state travel?
I will have to defer to DSS for that question.
Because I'm seeing on here there is $66,000 training expense in the grant.
So I think Adrian could speak to that. This grant, as Susan said, has been approved already back in October. I think what finance is doing is setting it up in a way in our accounting system that it can be tracked all by itself. So really, you correct me if I'm wrong, Susan, we're not approving the grant tonight. We're approving Susan's group setting it up into its own cost center so it can be tracked. I have certainly heard the board tonight that there is concerns about travel.
I just saw that and I thought we better talk about it.
Yes, I know that there has been travel in the past involved with Family Justice Center. And when I don't know if that's a grant that's renewed every year or if it's a...
So it's a two-year grant and the $756,000 would be for the 2 years.
So when this grant comes back to be considered again for application, we will be sure and explain to the commissioners what the travel is
involved.
There may be travel with it, but since it's already been approved, we're in a position where we would want to send these folks.
Right.
Yeah, it says participant travel, $30,000.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So we had a motion and a second to approve that ordinance, I believe. Do we know?
That's just to set it up on for financial reasons.
Yes, sir.
That's right.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
An RHA MOE contract extension.
So, Commissioners, we have for your consideration and would need a vote tonight, a proposed contract between Alamance County and RHA Health Services. RHA Health Services provides mental health crisis services at their Ann Elizabeth Drive location there near Holly Hill Mall. The current contract between the county and RHA expires June 30th
2019. And the contract in your packet would extend that contract period for 6 months until December 31st, 2019. And in the contract, we are proposing a maximum cost for the six-month period of $542,805. That's one half of what we normally allocate. We usually allocate every year, but we're only extending this contract for 6 months, so that's frozen at one half. These funds come from Alamance. They are Alamance County dollars, but they are required by law to be spent on mental health services. So we have funds called maintenance of effort that we are required. Once the state removed the LME from the county, they required that we spend $1.2 million every year on mental health services. This is part of that money. Must be spent on mental health crisis service provision. So between July 1st and September 1st, the county, my office, and the health department will be working to compile an RFP to get bids for this service. This is not to say we haven't been pleased with RHA. They do a good job, but we need to put this out for bid. One, to just better define the service that we want, and we hope to extend our crisis hours. Right now, the hours of crisis service, I believe, are 12 hours. And through this whole Stepping Up initiative, the idea has been to try to take crisis to 24 hours. We may be able to do that with the money that we have. We're going to try to see what the best cost we can get. So tonight I'm asking that you approve this contract between the county and RHA for 6 months. The maximum dollar to be spent, $542,805 from the Alamance County Mental Health Maintenance of Effort Fund.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, we have the Social Services Annual Written Agreement.
So I'm going to stand here. I think Adrienne Day is going to join me. This is the... Okay.
She went out in the back door, I think.
Here she is. Come on in. So this agreement is between the county and the Department of Health and Human Services in Raleigh for the provision of DSS services. We're under this agreement now. This is a renewal for another year of this agreement. And basically what it does, you know, this started, I think, 2 years ago, or I believe that's correct, where the state lays out in here the expectations they have of DSS. And the county's responsible to make sure that we work with DSS to make sure they meet those targets. So I don't know, Stacey, if you'd like, Adrienne, if you'd like to comment on this too.
No, this year, if you recall, last year we had 26 measures that we had to meet. And I think after all the counties signed the agreement, I think the state realized that there was not a measure to be able to track those things that they wanted to achieve. So this year there are 13 measures in there, and the tracking mechanisms have already been verified. So I mean, it's pretty straightforward.
It's important to note, and I think it's important for me to bring to the commissioners to consider that, you know, the state is going to be working closely to make sure DSS hits those mm-hmm. targets, and they're going to be wanting the county to do everything we can to help them do that. So we'll be sharing this data with DSS and keeping a close eye on it too, because we have a real stake in this. So
when will you get your report card?
So we get it every month.
Every month.
And certain, you know, there are only four areas that they're measuring. All of our child support measures are annual measures, even though they track them quarterly. Mm-hmm.
So you bring us up to date quarterly?
Absolutely.
Okay.
So this does require, we would ask for a motion, and if I'm not mistaken, Adrienne and I are actually the signers of this, but we would ask that the board vote to approve if that's accepted.
I'll move that we accept that.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the annual written agreement for social services with the Department of Health and Human Services. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, Mr. Albright, it's time to talk about the resolution.
All right. I did a careful study of case law in North Carolina, and I also want to bring to your attention that even as we speak, Senate Bill 355 has grown legs and it's working its way through the General Assembly. Here's why that's important. In a memo that I wrote you a week ago, I talked to you about section 6-21.7.
Right.
Where attorney's fees can be awarded, may be awarded, if a county is determined to have violated its authority or exceeded its authority. Senate Bill 355 changes that from may to shall be awarded. So I think it increases our danger. It also says that if the board takes action inconsistent with case law that set forth unambiguous limits within the case, we could be held exceeding our authority. Here's what that means. This is a vested right, this permit that's been issued. Like it or not, it's a vested right. They got their permit. It's moved out of our sphere of jurisdiction. It's out of our jurisdiction at this point. It's in the state hands to rule on water quality, air quality, Mining Commission Division of DEQ. That's why I wrote the proposed resolution the way I did. It says you're not taking a position on the issuance or denial permit. Now, if you may recall, the pipeline company wrote a letter to DEQ. They said the same thing. They're aware of this statute as well. That is the danger, I think, you've got in proceeding. And the North Carolina Supreme Court ruled on this issue in Hillsborough versus Smith on these issues of vested rights and a board exceeding its authority. The Supreme Court of the United States ruled on the same issue in the Village of Willowbrook versus Olek, which is a 2000 decision of the U.S. Supreme Court, and found violations of equal protection under the U.S. Constitution in that case. That's why I've been deliberate in this resolution. There's nothing stopping the Snow Camp mine people, anti-mine people, from going to Raleigh, filing their own petition as a mining group. They have their own lawyer, and they can certainly do that. And the issues set forth in the proposed resolution cover the concerns that I believe they have. This is public safety, negative consequences for the county air, lakes, streams, Hall River, as well as domestic, agricultural, and business water supplies, all of which are very important things. But as I said before, these have now passed into the jurisdiction of the DEQ. So I recommend this resolution that I have presented and prepared for you. I've not seen the anti-mining group's resolution.
But I believe a copy of it right here.
Yeah, right here. They just struck a couple sentences out, basically.
I believe it's risky to have a statement in that, may I?
Sure.
It is very risky to have a statement saying we want you to deny a permit.
Our statement is consideration. If you took out the thing advocating, I mean, it's an opinion of the board. We're talking about a resolution. We're not. I'm a little confused in this myself because a resolution, we send resolutions to Raleigh. We send them here, there, and everywhere. And most time they just, I don't know where they end up, whose trash can. But
those resolutions rarely deal with vested rights and real property. With a company that's got enough money to buy $4 million worth of property and pay attorneys. That's what bothers me about this. Now, the board can change this any way you want to change it. My recommendation is the one that I prepared.
Do you see anything in the recommendations from the mining, from the group opposed to the mine that would be a problem for you?
I mean, the only thing they struck is some of the.
Okay. First, whereas change is fine. Second one, not a problem.
And I don't think they want us to get in trouble any more than we want to, so.
Well, this whereas clause that has everything highlighted here, there's no requirement in our ordinance to get anybody notice of anything. That's an ordinance that this board approved. It's local law, passed in 2011. Like it or not, That's local law. Mm-hmm. So to say that without notification review by the commissioners, there's no requirement that the commissioners be notified to review. So that's a little disingenuous. I would take that out. I would recommend the board take it out. Of course, all of this is up to the board, but we want to be forthcoming with this state agency.
Would we be appropriate to say something to the effect of the ordinance in place at the time did not require notification?
Sure. We could change that.
That way it's clear that...
So the permit was issued, the ordinance was... Notification was not required under the Alamance County
right.
ordinance. Okay. All right. And the resolution, if you want to take out the part about advocating that the permit be denied, it's up to the board.
Beg your pardon?
I think it makes it a little stronger to leave that in, but if we take it out.
I think we should leave it in. I mean, that was your, after your research on the issue and thought that, you know, that would be better at protecting the interests of the county. And I'm very, very sensitive to the concerns of the Snow County, you know, the people, the neighbors of the proposed mine. I'm very, very concerned and sensitive to that. But we represent all the people of Alamance County, and we have to be sure that, we're, you know, my taxes go to pay if the county is sued and the poor people win. You know, your taxes do. We're all in it together to that degree. And so that's why I would prefer personally that we leave the therefore clause the same as drafted by Mr. Albright, but maybe incorporate those three whereas changes that
all right.
were suggested. Unless you see a problem with them.
No. I think it'd be fine to leave the changes they suggest in first whereas, let me see, the third whereas clause, the fourth whereas clause, and the third whereas clause with the exception of clarifying that notification was not required
right.
by the heavy industry ordinance. And then we'll leave the therefore the way proposed. All right, I can make those changes and get them to you. I will say this bill that is rocketing through our legislature is 127 pages long, and it significantly changes land regulation in the state of North Carolina. Significantly changes it. So I think this is the signal for us, if we're going to do zoning, maybe now's the time, because they're pushing more and more of this on the campus.
Right. I think that's a point well taken. Do you need to redraft your resolution
it.
And then we have it on the next for the next meeting, or should we vote on it as amended tonight?
I would say we could vote on it as amended
sure.
tonight.
That's what I'm thinking.
I mean, we're doing a resolution.
Right. I'll make the changes and get them to you tomorrow morning.
Okay. Does anybody want to make a motion that we approve the resolution as amended?
As amended.
Uh-huh. Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the resolution as amended. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
You know, in all honesty, the part that you want to take out about the resolution or denial, that's a linguistic debate right there. I'm not sure that leaving it in doesn't have the emotions that I don't want to divorce you, but if you understand what I'm saying.
Well, I guess it's where you put the emphasis on what syllable.
Mm-hmm. So I'm not sure it doesn't help it.
Okay, we've got some year-end budget amendments.
Good evening, Commissioners. Before you tonight is our year-end budget amendments. We would be amending our general fund by $1.7 million and our emergency telephone system by $67,805.04. What this is doing, it is taking money. Board has to approve if we are transferring between departments, and some of this is moving some insurance and bond funds from one department to another, as well as our merit pay and benefits and vacation leave payout. Printer security for our badge system. The HR department and the sheriff are teaming with that, and the sheriff has asked that $3,000 be transferred from his budget to the HR department. That's in here, as well as budgeting contingency for our jail valves. winter storm and hurricane relief, increase to the medical examiner, TDA, we are amending our budget to reflect the revenue that has received and the monies that we will need to send to the authority by the end of the fiscal year, adjusting for our grant revenues for the home care community block grant, transfer for sales tax, we would be increasing our budget by $700,000 to reflect the increase that we expect between now and the end of the fiscal year for our sales tax, so that that transfer would be fully budgeted for. And for the transfer to our emergency telephone system is for ineligible expenses as deemed by the E911 board. And what this request also does, it will authorize me to make the budget amendment that I will need to make for our fire district taxes that we will receive by June 30th.
So moved.
Is that a motion, Bill?
Yeah.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to accept those year-end budget amendments. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, we didn't have any public speakers for the non-agenda items, and so, Mr. Haga, do you have a report?
The only thing I want to bring to the board's attention is that our landfill folks, our landfill staff, have been working with Orange County and Durham County. Orange County Landfill is applying for a grant to work with Durham and Alamance County to establish a regional glass recycling effort. You are well aware, I'm sure, of the issues that are going on in the recycled market right now. Glass is one issue, one substance that we have a hard time finding places to recycle to. So we're looking to work with Orange County and Durham. Orange will apply for a grant. We would take glass, some glass from Alamance County to Orange County. Orange County would take ours and Durham's and put it with theirs and take it to Wilson County. The landfill would be looking to purchase a new dumpster to do this with. It's about a $7,800 purchase. My understanding is they will receive about 80% of that back from the Orange County grant if it's successful. The landfill would be installing signage at the landfill, talking about glass recycling, and put together some educational materials. The good thing about this regional effort with Durham and Orange County is that it allows us another option to get rid of glass, which is just another recyclable issue. I appreciate the landfill trying to find ways to keep recycling materials out of the landfill. We want to keep them out, but we just have to find someplace else for them to go. So this is a one-year deal that the landfill will be working out with the other two counties. They can opt out if it doesn't work out after the year. But I thought it was an innovative thing that Richards folks have been working to try to do. I appreciate that. So, and you know, I think that's indicative of what we've heard from the county gov folks about how I think every one of my ass said the favorite thing they went to was the landfill. They had a great time and learned a whole lot. And they are innovative.
There's a lot down there to learn.
Indeed. It's just a very good operation. I think this is just a sign of that. So. Now, no action, but
most of this glass is coming from residential people bringing it to the site, because doesn't Republic have their own recycling deal?
Yes, that's my understanding. I don't know if Richard's still here somewhere, and he
yeah,
may not
true.
Be.
Yes. So they take it to Murph in Greensboro.
That's correct.
That's all right. We don't need you now, Richard.
Come on, come on. Just
there's no action on this. Just yeah. Just bring it to the board's attention. So. And that's all that I have.
Okay. Any commissioner comments?
I just want to say, Brian, thank you for what you did and your staff and everybody with working through this budget. It's been a commendable process, and y'all did a good job. And I like the idea of moving forward that the public should know what's going on, because it's going to be posted. And if they don't know, it's going to be up to them. Good job.
Anybody else? If there's nothing further, one will be adjourned.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Local Gov TV. please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGovTV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.